So, man, like, thanks for doing this. I'm really glad we could do this.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, so tell me a little bit about your story.
Oh, you're not going to believe my story, man. It's crazy. So, I grew up the son of a very wealthy man, a lot of land, in charge of a lot of people, right?
So, that must have been, like, a ton of pressure on you as a kid.
Yeah, kind of. It was a ton of pressure. Plus, I had this crazy uncle who was jealous of my dad. So, my family was, it was crazy. He's a scary guy.
What was so scary about him?
Well, he had this huge scar on his face, so we called him Scar, Uncle Scar.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, anyway, okay. My dad tells me one day, hey, go wait out by this tree in the middle of our land, and so I'm out there waiting, and guess what happens? I feel the earth begin to shake, right?
Okay.
And this loud roar is coming. Guess what it is? It's a whole pack of wildebeest headed right for me. What? Right before they got there, my dad scoops me up and rescues me.
Oh, wait, a pack of wildebeests?
I know it's hard to believe, but guess who else was there?
Your Uncle Scar.
Yeah, that's weird. How'd you know that?
This is the plot of Lion King, right?
No. This is my story. And so my uncle's there because he has this whole mastermind plan to take over the kingdom.
Yeah, see, the kingdom. That's Lion King.
No, this is my story. And so he had this whole plan, and my dad ended up, like, holding me up on this mountain. And he says, Dylan, look at all of this land.
Yeah, that's definitely Lion King.
No, it's my story. I'm serious. My story.
Look, just tell me your story.
Say Hello? Something, I'm giving up on you.
Just tell me your story.
Welcome, everybody. So great to have all of you with us here at the North Campus and at the East Campus and the West Campus. We're continuing in a series called Just Talk About It because it's super weird when we don't talk. What's even more weird is when we do talk, but we tell a story that isn't true. How many of you have ever met someone like Dylan? Okay, anybody, all of our campuses? Someone trying to pass off someone else's story as their own? We're all tempted to do this because some of us feel like our story isn't interesting enough. We're going to talk today about your story and why it's so powerful just the way it is. I had a friend in middle school who was a lot like that. He called me one day and he would always make up stories. You could never quite tell if he was being truthful. Calls me one day, says, Lane, you won't believe this, but I ran away from home. I'm actually in another state. My parents don't know. I don't know if I'll ever be reunited with them. I may never see you again. Goodbye. Okay, so he hangs up the phone. I'm like, okay, cool. I guess I'll never see him again, or I'll see him tomorrow. Go to school the next day, and he's there, right? This guy is there. And I said, hey, that's crazy. Like, what brought you back? And he went into this whole story about how he got rescued and hitchhiked back and the whole deal. And I could just never, ever get him to just tell his story. And maybe you know someone like him, or maybe you know someone like Dylan, right, who makes the Lion King story. All of us have a tendency to discount our own story, to be tempted to think that someone else's story is going to be really powerful, but my story, no one's interested in it. And this is partly because we're familiar with our story. It's ordinary to us. And so for us, we just kind of look at our story and we think, well, who would be interested in this? But today we're going to talk about how powerful it can be when you tell your story. Now, as we get started, I just want to ask a question. How many of you at all of our campuses love telling stories? Anybody? Okay. There's like almost no hands going up, right? Just a few. And the reason why we kind of hesitate at that question, we're like, I don't know if I love telling stories, is when we think about storytellers, we think about people who are just really gifted at telling stories. And, you know, it's kind of, they just, everybody gathers around and it's story time. But if you think about it, you tell stories all the time. You just need the right topic. Like for some of you, especially dads, how many dads we have in the room today? Happy Father's Day once again. Some of you dads, you're fishermen, right? You go fish and you come back with a story, right? It was this big the next time you tell the story. How big is it? Is it smaller or bigger? It's bigger, right? It's this big, okay? The next time it's that big. The great thing is these days with social media, you can't really do that anymore because we could go pull up the evidence and be like, we can tell how big it is, right? Or some of us, we love to tell stories about vacation. How many of you love to travel? All of our campuses may love to travel. I love to travel. I love to come back and talk about the vacation I went on. For some of you, you went on that cruise that you'd been waiting your whole life to go on. And it doesn't matter that you did the 5-day and not the 9-day. It still was awesome. You know, it doesn't matter that your ocean view room meant a window this big. Okay, you were looking at the ocean. Okay, like your story, your vacation. We love to tell that. We love to tell stories about our kids. Okay, all you got to do is ask. All you got to do is bump into me, and I'll say, hey, you know, the other day my daughter, blah blah. Like I love telling stories about my kids. And given the right moment, you love to tell stories about your kids. And we love to do that even if no one cares. No one's listening, right? Sometimes I can just be found mumbling a story about my kid, right? Because we love to talk about our kids, about our lives, about the person who cut us off in traffic today on the way to work, or the person who cut us off, or the person who did the wrong thing to us. And all of us love, at some point, just given the right context, to tell a story, even if we don't realize it. So what I want you to understand is that you and I are already doing everything we need to change the world through our story. Because we're going to talk today about how incredibly powerful stories are. In fact, last week, if you weren't here, you can go back. Definitely check out Pastor Rodney's message from last week. He talked about the power of questions. And one of the things we saw in that was that Jesus actually asked 307 questions in the New Testament, 307 questions, and he only answered three. So what do we get from that? We get that questions, asking questions, was one of the most common and powerful tools Jesus used because it draws people out, gets them to come out of their shell and answer a question versus always telling them the answer. The other thing that we see in the New Testament is that Jesus actually told 46 different stories in the four books of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, 46 different stories. This is a pretty amazing thing that Jesus used questions and story as his primary means of teaching. In fact, most of the Bible is story. Most of the Bible is narrative more than it is teaching content. So there must be something to story. There must be something about the power of story and the power of storytelling and the power of your story. In fact, what if I told you that stories were powerful enough that they're one of the two things that we have, one of two weapons that we have that literally defeat Satan himself, that literally our story, the story of what God's done in our life, here at the North Campus, at the East Campus, at the West Campus, the story of what God's done in your life is the thing, the weapon you have to defeat Satan himself and defeat hell. Let me show you where I get that. From Revelation 12, 11, it says, "And they overcame him." This is talking about the accuser, Satan, the one who accuses, makes accusations against us day and night, the accuser. They overcame him, Satan, because of two things. The first thing is the blood of the Lamb. This is a reference to Jesus and his sacrifice on the cross for our sins. That Jesus lived the life that we couldn't live, a perfect life, and he died in our place for our sins so that we could be forgiven, restored, and made new and have a relationship with God through Jesus, the blood of the Lamb. So when the accuser throws accusations at you and throws accusations at you, you can say, I have been set free, I have been covered, I have been cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. So you can't defeat me. That's number one. The second thing is because of the word of their, we're going to say this word together, all three campuses, 1, 2, 3, testimony. The word of their testimony. Now, what is testimony? Testimony is just a fancy Bible way of saying story, okay? The words of their story. And it really is a particular kind of story when it's a testimony. It's a story of what God has done in your life. So your story of what God's done, your story of what Jesus has done, along with the blood of the Lamb is the two things that you have to defeat Satan himself. So stories are incredibly powerful. What I love is when research and science and the Bible kind of come together and complement one another. A lot of times we can have the misconception that you know the Bible and science are at odds and you've got to pick one, right? You just got to choose, like, I'm either a science person or a Bible person. I love when they come together and they say the same thing and we just see in science backing up what God said. So here's another piece of research, some science behind the power of stories. So this is from Harry Truscott. This is from an article called Why Do We Love Stories? She says, when information is delivered in the form of a story, other areas, that's other areas of the brain, become activated as well, such as the sensory cortex and motor cortex. These are the parts of the brain typically triggered when we experience events firsthand. So here's what this is saying. This is so profound. This means that when you hear a story, you actually place yourself in that story as if you're experiencing it as part of the story, firsthand. So let me explain how this works. How many of you ever heard of the movie Toy Story? Okay, Toy Story, all of our campuses. Toy Story 4 is about to come out. It's been a few years since the last Toy Story. Toy Story 3 came out in 2010, and it did really well. It was actually nominated for Best Picture, first time in history that an animated sequel was nominated for Best Picture. It's a huge, huge, huge movie. And what made it so powerful was the story that was told. So if you don't know much about Toy Story, in the movie, you've got these toys that are toys, and then when their boy, his name is Andy, the boy who owns the toys, when he kind of goes away and shuts the door, they come alive, and there's this little community of toys that live and talk to each other and things like that, and they have this whole ecosystem of toys. So Toy Story 3, there's this really powerful scene where Andy is about to go off to college, and he's put all of his toys in a box, and he's contemplating, you know, giving them away, and he's kind of remembering his toys. And the way they kind of put all that together, you actually experience the pain that these toys feel, that they're about to get thrown into a box and shipped off to some donation place and never seen again. You feel this sense of agony they have that, no, Andy, not you, you know, keep us, don't you love us? You could see it on their faces. It's incredible. And so millions of people sat in theaters and shed real tears over animated, make-believe toys that came to life, right? Who were sad. So we felt along with these toys, okay? Pretty powerful thing. It just goes to show how powerful stories are, that we put ourselves in the story. Another example is a movie called Up. How many of you have seen Up? Okay, this is another Pixar film. So Up starts out, and there's this grumpy old man, and he's got this one house, this old house, and he's living in it alone, and all around the house is a bunch of construction workers that are kind of surveying the land and tearing houses out and stuff, and all that's left is his house, and they tell you the story of how it got to that point. They go back to his childhood, and you see him meet his wife, and they become good friends, you know, and then one day they realize, wow, we kind of like each other, and they start dating, and then they get married, and then you kind of walk through each step of their life. They get pregnant, and then they miscarry the child, real painful, tragic situation, and then they kind of move on from that, decide not to have kids. They grow old together, and then he buries his wife. She gets sick, and she dies, and he says goodbye to her, and then it's just him and this house. And so at the end of all that, it's a three-minute montage, you're down to this one old man and this old house, and these evil developers are trying to take it out from under him, and you feel his pain. He's made up, okay? He doesn't even exist, right? But millions of people sat in theaters and watched in their homes and shed real tears over a made-up man. And it's not because we necessarily feel badly for the guy in Up. We're not necessarily thinking about him. We're thinking about us. We're thinking about the people that we take for granted. We're thinking about the people who we lost. We're thinking about the people who you know, in our lives who are suffering. Those are the things that happen when we put ourselves in a story. And so it goes to show you that a story well told can be such a powerful thing. And I'm going to show you today, and you're going to see in Scripture that your story well told, your story, simple, straightforward story, is one of the most powerful tools that you have. And in fact, both of those movies, the Toy Story series and Up, are made by Pixar. And Pixar is so tenacious about the story that they have to get the story completely perfect before they ever take a movie to animation and production. The story is where the power is, and they realize that. And so for you and for me, our story, you're gonna see today, and I hope you're gonna see today at all of our campuses, that your story is where the power is. That we don't have to make up a story like we saw in the video earlier. That we don't have to say, hey, guess what? I have the story of Lion King or whatever the case, right? We don't have to do that because our story, your story, my story has this kind of power. Let's see it right here. My story, your story, can change the world when Jesus, let's say Jesus together, all of our campuses, 1, 2, 3, Jesus, when Jesus is in the middle of it. So my story can make a difference. Your story can change the world. And now at this point, you might say, change the world? I mean, really? You don't know me. You don't know the life I've lived. You don't know the things that I've done or maybe the things that I haven't done. You don't know how interesting it is or uninteresting it is. I'm going to show you today. We're going to see in Scripture as we dive in to this story that we're going to see that even the simplest, most basic story can make a profound impact and have a ripple throughout history. And your story and my story can do the exact same thing. And the key is when Jesus is in the middle of it. Because whether it's a movie or whether it's something funny we're talking about, a story can just produce laughter and make us cry or make us laugh, and that's all well and good. But a story changes the world when Jesus is in the middle of it. And so what I want to show you is I want to walk you through a passage of Scripture. And what you're going to see is a guy who had a very simple life and had a very profound thing that happened to him because Jesus walked in the middle and his story radically changed. And what I want you to think about as we walk through this is I want you to think about your story. As we walk through this, I want you to think about how you would tell your story and maybe how you can relate to this guy. Because I think that in his story, we really see every story of where Jesus is in the middle. So if you have a Bible, go ahead and turn to John chapter 9. If you don't have a Bible, you can download one on your smartphone. If you have that, you can go to the app store and download the YouVersion Bible app, or in the lobby of your campus, you can go by Next Steps, and we'd love to give you a Bible. That's our gift to you today. So John chapter 9 is where we're going to pick up, and this is a story about a man who was born blind. We're going to see what happens to him. So let's jump right into John 9, starting in verse 1. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man who had been blind from birth. Rabbi, his disciples asked him, why was this man born blind? Was it because of his own sins or his parents' sins? So immediately where we go in the story is that there's a man who is blind. And right away, the disciples, I guess maybe they knew about this man. Later, we're going to find out that he was a beggar. So the disciples knew enough about him that he had been blind from birth. And yet, the disciples are just immediately assuming there must be something shady in his past. Like this guy, you know, did he sin? Did he do something wrong? Or maybe it was his parents who did something wrong and they passed it on to him. But God must be punishing him because he has something wrong with him. He must have done something that he shouldn't have done. Or he must have had a parent who did something that they shouldn't have done. And this must be because of sin. And they were living in the past. And so many of us have maybe people in our lives like that. Maybe we're tempted to go there sometimes. How many of you at all of our campuses have that person who will not let go of the past? Like that family member or friend who they have this hilarious story about you. It's like 16, you should have saw Jimmy 16 years ago. I mean, he was just, and you're sitting there going, okay, can we please just for once get together as a family and you not share that story just one time? Can we move past that, right? Or maybe we've all known the kind of high school football star, right? You know, they graduated in 1993, but they were a big deal back then and they can't stop talking about that. And it's like, I could throw a pigskin a quarter mile, right? Like Uncle Rico or whatever. And you're just like, okay, what have you done since you were 18? You know what I mean? Like, let's stop living in the past. But the disciples immediately went straight to, there must be something wrong with this guy. God must be mad at him. And often that same lie can find its way into our story, into our hearts and our minds. The way that often looks is we will say, God can use someone else's story, but he can't use mine. Because my past is too bad. Some of us have that line of thinking. My past is too bad. God can't change me, or God, even if God has, man, if people knew what I've done, if people knew what I was a part of, if people really understood where I've been in life, they wouldn't give me credibility. And for others of us, maybe if you are like me, where you grew up in church and in, you know, kind of a religious background and system, your tendency is to think, my past isn't bad enough, right? You're going, hey, I've never robbed a bank, I've never dealt drugs, I've never jaywalked. Like, how am I supposed to relate to the person who has the really sensational story? Like, let's let them tell their story and point to that and say, look at that powerful story. But the problem is, in both cases, whether we think our past is too bad or not bad enough, we are discounting the fact that God can step into a story, and when Jesus is in the middle of it, we're going to see what this means in a second. When Jesus is in the middle of the story, it changes everything. And so the disciples are buying into this lie, and Jesus won't let them get hung up on this. Here's what Jesus says. It was not because of his sins or his parents' sins. Jesus answered, this happened so the power of God could be seen in him. So ultimately, Jesus says, look, it has very, very little to do with his past, what he did, what he didn't do. He's blind and he's encountering me today because God's power is going to be on display. Do you see the theme that keeps creeping up? That there's power in the story. There's power in what God is doing. There's power in the fact that Jesus walked into a situation and changed it up. And so here's what I want us to see. I want us to see this right here. What my past is a backstory, but not the whole story. My past is a backstory. It is my story. I can't do anything to change it. West Campus, East Campus, you can't do anything to change your story. None of us can. But here's what we can understand. My past is a backstory, but it is not the whole story. And if I let it become my whole story, if I let it define me, if I say, well, I did this, I cannot move past it, then I am discounting the power that happens when Jesus walks into a story and changes things up. So here's what I want for us today. I want for us to look at this guy's story and just imagine. This is a guy who probably felt, because he had always been told, you're blind, you're always gonna be blind. And in these days, because that was tied to a sin in people's minds, like you must have done something wrong, he would have been excluded from society. He was a beggar, probably because he had no way to make a living. So he was just reduced to begging as a blind man. And he probably thought, this defines me, I'm never gonna have a different story. Until Jesus steps in, and that backstory no longer is the whole story. So I wonder for you, what would be the backstory that you have? And maybe today we discover that it's not the whole story, it's just the backstory. So from here, it goes on. Then Jesus spit on the ground, made mud with the saliva, and spread the mud over the blind man's eyes. He told him, go wash yourself in the pool of Siloam. So this is a totally and completely normal way and conventional way to heal a blind person, wouldn't you say? East Campus, well, I mean, if you were going to heal a blind person, would you not spit in the dirt, make mud, put it on their eyes, and go tell them to take a bath, okay? Probably not, right? Like, can we just admit, you know, this is in the Bible, and it's weird, okay? This is a weird, unconventional way to heal someone. And I think the thing is, Jesus could have just looked at this guy and said, thou seest. Okay, and he would have just, his eyes could have been open. Jesus could have just decided to heal this guy. He could have patted him on the back and he said, go and see for the first time, right? But instead, it's messy, right? It's like, what is Jesus doing here? And I think the thing I want to just pause before we go to what happens, I want to acknowledge this right here, that when Jesus comes into the middle of my story, it can look messy. I think we need to hear this because often, here's what we're told, especially for those of us who, you know, kind of grew up in the Bible Belt, maybe around church or going to church, we're told that basically the way that you encounter Jesus, the way that you have Jesus in the middle of the story is you hear a sermon, you walk an aisle, you pray a prayer, and you get dunked. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now you're in the door, okay, or whatever, okay? And we just think it's going to be simple. And here's the problem with that. All of us in our lives have messes, right? It's messy in the middle. There's times where we go, is this normal? Like, I feel like I take one step towards Jesus and then I take two steps back and he keeps pulling me in and I'm just not sure. And the thing that I love about this church, the thing that I love about One Life is that there's mess in the middle and we embrace that. If you're here and you're searching and you're trying to discover and you don't quite know and you feel like it's messy, you're in the right place. Because you can walk through your mess and we'll just walk through it with you. Because it's never completely clean and neat and put together when Jesus steps in the middle. Because sometimes we have a lot to get put together. We have a lot of mess and Jesus steps right in the middle of that. And sometimes he puts mud on our eyes and says, go take a bath. And we say, well, that's weird, right? But we don't see the whole story. Like, have you ever seen an artist painting a picture? You ever watched that? You know, and they start out, and then the artist knows what they're doing. They're painting, you know, and they're putting it together. And if you were to walk up to an artist, East Campus, West Campus, walk up to an artist midway through their painting, tap them on the shoulder and say, I'm not seeing it. It looks kind of messy. I mean, is this it? Are you done? Like, what is that artist going to do, right? The artist is probably going to take great offense, okay? They're going to be very mad at you for a long time, right? Because there's a mess in the middle, but it's not the whole story. When I get my hair cut, I typically wear contacts most of the time. But when I get my hair cut, I always try to remember to wear glasses. And I sit down, I take my glasses off, and I put them on the counter. And the reason why I do this is because I don't want to see what's going on, all right? I will sit there, and I will watch my hair take shape. But in the middle, it's pretty messy. So the whole time I'm going, oh, does he know that this side is a little bit less faded than that side? And my hard part's a little thin. And man, this is a work of art. You can't screw it up, buddy, you know? And the whole time I'm just watching and it's misery. And I never say anything, but the whole time I'm just like, please, please. So I don't wear my glasses. It's just a big fuzz. That's all I can see. Just a big fuzzy fuzz mess. And they always spin me around. Happens every time. Spin me around. What do you think? I'm like, I don't know. I trust you. Let me put my glasses on. Oh, yeah. Turns out it looks great, right? Because the mess in the middle is not the whole story. When Jesus comes into our story, it's no different. He comes into this guy's life. And instead of just making it easy and simple and clean and conventional, he chooses to just step into the mess with this guy. Almost as if to acknowledge the struggle. Hey, I know this has been tough. And then he asks him to do something. He says, go wash in the pool of Siloam. And we're going to see what happens next. Here's what happens. So the man went and washed and came back seeing. How cool is that? Like this guy who could not see his whole life, just imagine, blind, darkness, okay? Never saw a shape, never saw a color, never saw a human's face, never saw a flower. All of a sudden, his eyes are opened and he can see. He went and he came back seeing. This is amazing. And what this tells me is that this guy, when this happened, he could have said, you know what, Jesus, listen, I appreciate your thought here. And, you know, last week some guy came and he told me if I chewed on sand, that would restore my sight. That didn't work either. And the 100 times before that somebody had an idea, those never worked either. So you know what? Thanks, but no thanks. I'm just gonna do my own thing. Could have wiped the mud out of his eyes and he could have went back to begging. But he went and washed. He did the thing. As weird as it was, he went and did it. And as a result, he came back seeing. And here's what I think I get from this for you and me. When I let Jesus be in the middle of my story, radical change happens. Radical change happens. As weird as it was to go wash in the pool, he went and did it. He could not have known the whole story. He actually could have, you know, who knows? He maybe could have thought, is this a joke? Is everybody going to laugh at me when I get out of the pool? Is this going to be just another moment of despair? But instead, he chose to trust the master and follow. He just did it. And I wonder, what is God calling you to do today? What is God asking you to do today that if you just took a step in that direction and said, I don't know every bit of this story, but I'm going to walk through the door? Because often, we don't know the end result. Like, for example, when you go and start a sport for the first time, like if you start football training, football starts in the fall, but you start training maybe in May or June for the fall season. Well, initially, you're going to be doing all kinds of drills and conditioning that have very little to do with plays and football itself, but the coach knows that he's getting you ready for what's coming, right? So if you just trust the expert and you go through the motions, eventually radical change happens and you become a player who hopefully doesn't get injured, right, and plays well. Or how many of you do the chef in a box thing, the HelloFresh, red bandit, blue apron, anybody do that, all campuses? So my wife and I, we subscribe to this service called HelloFresh, where we get a box and in it there's food and you take the food out and there's recipes and it's all there, totally portioned, and you make the food. It sounds really simple, but you have to chop every little thing. You have to do, there's certain skills associated with it. And there's a recipe, and often you're taking the grease that you're cooking with over here and you're moving it over here, and then you're taking half of this, and all these pieces are kind of floating around. And if you just follow the steps, if you just do what it says, eventually what comes together is actually a really tasty meal. Radical change. That's what happens. It's the exact same way with Jesus. That Jesus says, let me be in the middle of your story. Come follow me. Come do this. And maybe it's messy. Maybe it's not conventional. Maybe you can't figure it out. But if you just take that step, you can't see the end from the beginning. But Jesus is working it out. It's kind of like in our series a few weeks ago, the Hope series, where Pastor Rodney held up a puzzle piece and said, often God is telling, he's creating the whole story of our lives, but all we see is this piece. If we trust him with this peace and we take that step, then radical change can happen. So if we think about it, what's happened so far with this guy is he was blind, he met Jesus, now he can see. And this starts to become his story. He's going to say this here in a little bit, but this has become his refrain throughout this. Because everybody's asking him, hey, what happened? I was blind, I met Jesus, and now I can see. Simple story, and you're going to see that everybody's trying to complicate it. And this is common in our experience as well. So his neighbors and others who knew him as a blind beggar asked each other, isn't this the man who used to sit and beg? And they go on from there, and they're kind of like, oh, one person's like, I think he is. And another person's like, I'm not so sure. And they're like, yeah, it's probably not him. And so he steps up. The beggar kept saying, yes, I am the same one. He's like, hey, over here. Like, remember me? I literally couldn't see earlier today. Now I can see. Okay? So then they go on to ask him. They asked, who healed you? What happened? And he told them, the man they call Jesus. And so obviously he probably knew about Jesus at this point. He probably had heard stories. And so he just goes into, hey, listen, the man they call Jesus, he came, he put mud on my eyes, he sent me away, and I did what he said to do, and now I can see. I was blind, I met Jesus, and now I can see. I was blind, I met Jesus, and now I can see. Simple, simple story. But here's the problem. They wanted to complicate it, right? They just couldn't accept that God had done this. They couldn't accept that it could be that simple. Have you ever met someone that just loves to complicate things at all of our campuses? Like, if you take your car into the mechanic and you say, hey, it's making a noise. Could you fix it? And they say, yeah, well, the reason why it's making a noise is because the manifold drive with the bearings and they go into this whole explanation and you're going, I don't know anything about what you're talking about. All I want to do is have a car that runs. Maybe that's just me. Some of you guys might be judging me right now, but the point is, we love to complicate simple things, right? And so the neighbors, they're like, there's got to be more to this story. So they drag him to church. They drag him to the Pharisees. Now, the Pharisees were the religious folks. These were the rule setters. These were the people who were the religious and moral elite of the day. They loved to boss everybody around, make the rules, judge everybody. And so this guy, if you can imagine, if you're the blind guy at this point, you're probably going, hey, listen, I thought seeing was going to be great. Okay? I really had some major, major expectations of what this day might be like. And you guys are kind of ruining it for me because now you're going to drag me to church to see if I broke a rule with how I started to see. Okay? So he goes on. Here's what it says. The Pharisees, okay, the religious and moral elite, again questioned the man who had been blind and demanded, what's your opinion about this man who healed you? Okay, can we just acknowledge all of our campuses? This is a dumb question, okay? What's your opinion about this man who healed you? Oh, okay, well, let me deliberate a little bit. My opinion, I think he's a neat guy. I think he's really swell. He's awesome, okay? He gave me sight. Like, I literally couldn't see. I met him, and now I can see. What do you mean, what's my opinion, right? But they're just looking at this guy going, there's got to be more to the story. It's got to be more complicated. The man replied, I think he must be a prophet. So they go into this debate where the Pharisees are mad that Jesus healed him on the Sabbath. The Sabbath was the day that you were supposed to rest. So if you see a blind man on the Sabbath, you just let him go on being blind because it's the Sabbath, right? Well, Jesus loved kind of breaking those rules, and he just said, hey, you know what? Guy can't see, I'm going to let him see. So the Pharisees said, ah, it's illegitimate. The radical change that happened in this guy's life is illegitimate because it didn't happen the exact right way. And so they start firing off, hey, listen, this guy's probably a sinner. he did this on the Sabbath. And here's the response, the famous response from this guy where he tells his story in one line. Are you ready for it? Here's what he says. "I don't know whether he is a sinner," the man replied, "but I know this. I was blind, and now I can see." I was blind, comma. This comma is where Jesus comes in, right? I was blind, I met Jesus, and now I can see. This is his story. Again and again and again and again and again. He's telling his story. Listen, I don't know. I was blind, Jesus stepped in, now I can see. I was blind, Jesus stepped into my life, and now I can see. It's that simple. And here's what I think this tells us, and I hope this is an encouragement to you. That a simple story with Jesus in the middle is a powerful story. A simple story with Jesus in the middle is a powerful story. This is true for us. Your story, we're going to hear in a little bit, we're going to actually help you shape and form and know your story so you can tell it. And you might be tempted to think, my story is simple, it's not spectacular, it's not sensational, but a simple story with Jesus in the middle is a powerful story. Because here's what happens, he goes on and they keep questioning him. The tension from this little short story, this simple story, I was blind, I met Jesus, and now I can see. That produced enough tension and enough uncomfortableness that these guys, the Pharisees, the people who had all the answers, were asking tons of questions. Isn't that funny? Like these guys that were never curious, they had all the answers, all of a sudden they're leaning into this blind man saying, "Tell us about him. What happened? This is off the book. We don't know what to do with this." And finally, he looks at them and he says, "You seem to be very interested in this Jesus guy. Do you want to be one of his disciples?" What did he do there? All of a sudden, his story produced enough tension where he was starting to convince the unconvincible, and now he's asking a question. He's using the two things that we have, right? Questions, we talked about that last week, and our story. So he's saying, rather than trying to give you all the answers, let me just ask you a question. Do you want to be his disciple? Because I can tell you this, I was blind, I met Jesus, and now I can see. So a simple story with Jesus in the middle is a powerful story. So here's what I hope we can see. This idea right here, our big idea for the day. My story can change the world when Jesus is in the middle of it. So that's the end of the blind man, okay? I want to shift gears to you because here's what I hope you understand. You are already, we talked about this at the beginning, you are already doing everything you need to do to change the world. You're already telling stories. You're already sharing about your life. All you need to do is do it with more intention because your story, not someone else's, not Lion King's plot like what Dylan did, your story has the power to change the world when Jesus is in the middle of it. And so I want to help you through that with just a couple of questions. The first question is this. Do you have a story? Like, is there a point where Jesus entered your story and changed things up? Do you have a middle, right? Where Jesus came in, and Jesus, there's the past, Jesus comes in and he changed things, and there's a different future. I was blind, I met Jesus, and now I can see. Do you have that story? Because if you don't, here's what I would encourage you to do. Some of you don't have that story, and you know it. Because you've come, you've been around this stuff, you've been interested in faith, you've kind of put your foot in the water, but you haven't taken the leap. And maybe right now in this moment at all of our campuses would be the time where you would say, I'm tired of knowing about God, I want to know God. I'm tired of knowing about a story, I want to have a story. And so you might, right now in your seats in this very moment, say, Jesus, I give you my life. I want to give you control. I'm going to give my life to you. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my life. Make me a new person. Maybe that would happen right now. How cool would that be? That your story, Jesus would enter into the middle of your story today. And that can happen even in this moment. The second question is, do you know your story? Because I would argue that most of us, even if we have a story, we have a hard time articulating it. We have a hard time explaining it. Again, we try to complicate it, right? So I want to show you a simple framework for how to tell your story, how to know your story. So on your handout, you have these three words at the bottom. So if you would, please get your handout out and get a pen, okay? Everybody, I want to see movement, okay? It's Father's Day, kind of dads, lead the way, please. Grab a pen, grab a paper. You don't have to share this with anybody. I'm not going to ask you to turn it in at the end of class, okay? This is just something you're going to keep, okay? And here's what I would like for you to do. We're going to walk through these three words together, and in just a moment, you're actually going to write down a word for each one of these. I'm going to give you an example from my life. So my before Jesus, I knew, before when I was younger, I knew about God. I knew about him. I could have told you all kinds of stories. But then one day, I heard a story of what happens when someone meets God. And the example of a caterpillar turning into a butterfly was what someone used to explain that to me. And in a moment, it's as if it became real to me, and I realized that I don't have that story of transformation and newness. And so I met Jesus, and now I don't just know about God, I know God. And so for me, I would put, I knew about God, I met God, and now I know God, right? So another story from my life. Before, I thought being a disciple meant just knowing a lot, being able to answer people's questions. I had an experience with Jesus where he began to show me something different, and now I realize that living for Jesus is more about being on mission to see other people come to faith and then multiply their faith to others than it is about knowing. And so I used to just want to know a lot, and now I want to multiply because I met Jesus. I had an encounter with Jesus. So I don't know, what is it for you? I want to give you some words to kind of help think through what your story could be as you write these down. So let's talk about before. Write down your before. Maybe before you were in control because you would never give up control to anyone. Maybe your before you were in fear, okay? Maybe you had fear. You're writing these things down. What is your word at all of our campuses? What is your word for before? Maybe you were alone. Maybe you were scared. Maybe you were addicted. Maybe you were guilty. Maybe you felt like you were chained up. Maybe you were lonely. Maybe you were a mess. What is the word for you? And then what happened when you met Jesus? So this is the second word. So maybe when Jesus came along, Jesus entered your story and he showed you that you're not alone. He showed you that you're free. He showed you that you're loved. He showed you that you're forgiven. He showed you that you're found. So what's your word for Jesus? Write it down right now. And then after, okay? What happened after? Maybe after you're free. Maybe after you have let go of control. Maybe after you're forgiven. Maybe after you're cleansed. Maybe after Jesus, you have purpose where you were purposeless. Maybe after you have a newfound joy. Maybe after Jesus, you feel loved for the first time. Maybe you feel accepted. Do you see how simple this is? Before Jesus, I was alone. I met Jesus, and now I'm never alone. It really doesn't have to be more complicated than that. I was blind, I met Jesus, and now I can see. Between services, I had a man come up to me and actually show me the words that he wrote. And it was lost, found, forgiven. I was lost, Jesus found me, and now I'm forgiven. So powerful. So what is it for you? And here's my hope. My hope is that you would take that sheet and that you would help that to trigger in those conversations you have how to tell your story and when to tell your story. Because finally, as we wrap up, my story can change the world when Jesus is in the middle of it. The thing is, in your sphere of influence, the people that you live with, the people that you work with, the people that you play with, they don't want to hear from someone else. They don't want to hear someone else's story. Our temptation can be just to say, let me tell you, you got to come to church so you can hear my pastor tell his story, right? That's our temptation. But the problem is, you're the one they know. You're the one they like, maybe, okay? You're the one they trust. And when you tell your story, that Jesus is in the middle of it, it has the most profound impact on them. So my encouragement to you is to have a story. Give your life to Jesus. Know your story. Be able to communicate the stories that Jesus is continually telling. The story of when you ultimately gave your life to Jesus, and then day to day, week to week, what Jesus is continuing to do in your life. Before, had an encounter with Jesus, and then after. I can't imagine what would happen if all of us at all of our campuses would embrace the power of our story, not because of us, not because of how it's fun it is to tell stories or whatever, but because of the power that it shows of Jesus, because of displaying God's power, of glorifying him, making his name known, that we get to participate in that. and that when we tell our story, it has power. And so I pray that we would walk in that, that we were blind, we met Jesus, and now we can see. That's a story that we can tell. Let's pray. God, thanks so much for the fact that you chose to wire us in such a way that we actually really love hearing stories and telling stories, that stories are the way culture is passed down. It's the way meaning happens in the world. It's the way we understand the world around us. And in all of that, you gave us a story. God, we're so thankful for that. Don't let us waste our story by not ever telling it. Don't let us waste our story by not knowing it, not being able to share it. So right now, today, I pray that we would walk out of here and embrace the story that you're writing in our life. It's our story. Is it perfect? No, but you're in the middle of it. If you're in the middle of it, it's a powerful story and it can change the world. So God, we give this to you. I pray for anyone in here today who their story isn't fully complete yet because you're not in the middle of it. I pray that they would let you in. They would take that step and experience radical change even right now in this moment. And that all of us would leave here on mission to make a difference where we live, work, and play by the power of our story. We pray that you would enable us to do that. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand and sing?